Recently, I did an overview on the Grainfather G70 all-in-one brewing system. In today's video, we're going to be doing a brew day with almost a half pound of hops. Will it be successful? Will it clog up? Will it work? We'll find out. How's it going? My name's Brian. I'd like to welcome you to another video. If this is your first time here and you'd like to learn more about electric brewing, see how-to videos and brew day videos just like this one, consider subscribing. And if you do, don't forget to click that bell so you won't miss a video when it comes out. So I set about doing the recipe, and what I'm doing is a double dry hop, double IPA. I thought that would be a good test for the system, both, you know, the volume as well as how many hops I'm using in the recipe. Now the recipe will be available in the links below in the description on both Brewfather and Grainfather app. Now, one of the things that I did run into right off the bat when I made the recipe was that there were a couple things that I had to adjust in the app itself. And one of those was the efficiency. They had the efficiency default set to 80%. I set that down to 70 just because I wasn't really sure exactly what type of efficiency I was going to get with the system. And then also it had a default of 6 gallons, which was fine to me because I am doing a double dry hop. There are a lot of hops in there. So I wanted a little extra beer so that I could try to rack off as much clean as possible without a bunch of hop debris in it. One thing that was a little bit odd to me was that it showed 9 gallons of strike water, which seemed like quite a bit. And then the sparge water was like less than a gallon, which seemed a little bit odd because I'm like, yeah, I want to rinse the grains and all that sort of thing. But I thought, you know what, I'm just going to go ahead and go with it. This is the profile that Grainfather created. I went into the app, did a new brew to start the brew day. And that was the second time that I encountered an issue. It said to heat up like roughly 16 point something gallons. And I'm like, wait a minute now. It said 9 gallons in the recipe and now it says 16 gallons. I was completely confused and I wasn't sure. And so I went ahead and went to my Brewfather software, and the Brewfather app actually has the Grainfather profile in it. And so I recreated the recipe in there again. And then in that profile, it showed a little bit different volumes, like just a little over 9 gallons of strike water. And then it showed about 1.6 or so gallons of sparge water, which I thought was still a little bit light, but I thought, you know what, I'm just gonna go ahead and go with it. Apparently the recipe part of the app was more correct than the actual brew part of the app. Started the brew day and immediately I noticed another issue. The app is not taking into account the temperature of the grain. When you put it in the strike water, obviously the temperature drops. So I had to go and consult my Brewfather software again and actually add a mash step to the recipe. I had to quit the brew day, start all over, add a mash step to the recipe that said basically we're gonna mash at 157 degrees for 1 minute. That was the shortest time period that I could come up with in there, so that whenever I mashed in, I would be at the right temperature. So once the system heated up, it was time to mash in. So I went ahead and did that. As I was mashing in, I noticed that the mash seemed really, really thin to me. And you can kind of see here on video as I'm stirring everything in that the mash looks really, really thin, which kind of caused me a little bit of concern because of the fact I wasn't sure how that was going to affect the efficiency. But I went ahead and did that, mashed in, put the top screen on, lowered the center pipe all the way down so that it was touching the center screen or the top screen. Somebody had told me in my smaller Grainfather video that, oh, you're supposed to have it all the way down at the bottom so that it overflows, etc. So as with all these all-in-one systems that I've been doing recently, I let the mash rest for 10 minutes before even starting a pump or timer. So once the 10 minutes was up, I went ahead and started the flow on the mash recirculation as much as I could. One thing I do want to make very clear with this system is that if you open the valve all the way, the pump is too strong for the hose size and there's way too much pressure coming out of the hose, and it actually starts to whip around inside. I was almost afraid that it was going to actually whip up out of the kettle and start spraying water and wort everywhere. So just a cautionary tale on that. Don't open the valve all the way. But you know, and once I got everything tamed down with the hose, got everything recirculating, everything else went fine with the mash. I ran through that 157 temperature step for 1 minute, which didn't really affect anything. And then it settled right down into the 149. I'm happy to report that the mash temperature stayed at 149 the entire time. I didn't have any issues with any fluctuation or anything like that. So some other videos that I've seen where they had some issues with the mash temperature did not have that issue with my particular batch. And as you can see, the wort cleaned up really, really nicely. It was really, really clear. As I started to heat up for the mash out, I did notice that the grain probably swelled a little bit due to the temperature increase and it started to overflow into the center pipe. One thing there, this top screen doesn't really keep out all of the debris and stuff, so I wound up with quite a bit of particulate matter in the kettle because it was overflowing. I had to use a strainer to get all that out, or as much as I could out. Now for the sparge, I went ahead and used a winch system that I have, and I've used it previously on another system in the brewery here. It worked really well, grabbed the handle, raised it up, no problem, was able to twist it fine, put the legs on the retaining ring, and then I sparged with like 1.6 gallons of water. Once I did that and everything drained out, I determined that I was actually over on volume. Another issue with, I don't know, between the two softwares, one of them didn't get it right. I think there's some tweaking that has to be done on the profile. But I was supposed to wind up with a 8 gallon pre-boil and wound up with about 8¾ gallons. So I took a gravity reading. My pre-gravity reading was, pre-boil gravity reading was supposed to be 1070. It was 1055. So I decided that I would go ahead and boil off some of the liquid prior to actually starting the boil timer and getting going with the brew day. So I think it's probably about 30-ish minutes, something like that. It took to boil off that 3/4 of a gallon. I did boil off just a hair more than what I wanted to and started right at just a little under 8 gallons whenever I started the actual timer. But at that point, I was at like 1069 for my gravity, so I felt pretty good about that. Had several hop additions throughout the brew day, and a total of, I think it was about 7.5 ounces of hops, almost 1/2 pound of hops. So, you know, once everything was done, hooked up the counterflow chiller. One thing that I did like about the counterflow chiller is that after doing the sanitization process where you hook it up to the recirculation port and run the hot wort through there, you can actually unplug it and close the system up so that it keeps all that hot wort to keep everything nice and sanitized when you're doing what you, you know, whatever you need to do. In my case, it was a whirlpool, so I went ahead and, you know, did the sanitization of the chiller and then started my whirlpool, and that was pretty simple. I used a little clamp to put the hose down in the side of the kettle, and it created a fair whirlpool. It wasn't anything to really, you know, get excited about, but at least everything was moving. Dumped in the rest of my flame out hops, and then after that I just began doing the chilling process. And the chiller works really well. I mean, it chilled it down really, really quick. No problems with that at all. What I was really curious about after the brew day was done and started transferring over into the Grainfather conical fermenter, I was really wondering how it would react to all the hops. I'm actually happy to report that the bottom redesign, the bottom filter screen that they made, actually works really, really well. I was able to drain virtually all of the wort out and leave all of the debris behind, and didn't really have a whole lot in the fermenter. There was some smaller particulate matter that made it through the screen, but I mean, it left a nice mountain of hop debris on top of that filter down there. Once I was done with that, then it was a matter of cleaning. I did not use this small filter in the bottom in doing the final cleanup. And like I think that there could probably be some improvements on this. If this were a dome shape rather than a flat screen that went down into the bottom of the kettle, it would definitely be better because of the fact that it only has a small area that screen actually covers. And so it gets clogged really, really quickly. I mean, I saw another video that, you know, it showed how much it got clogged in the cleaning process. So I didn't even bother to use it. They probably don't recommend that, but ran PBW through the whole system, ran PBW through the chiller, did all the cleaning on it. Once I was done, I was able to wipe it out with a rag. There's a little bit of beer stone that was left in the bottom there, but not too much really to speak of. Something that can be easily cleaned up. I didn't spend a whole bunch of time trying to clean it up. I wanted to kind of let you guys see what it looked like after it was done cleaning without doing any major scrubbing or anything like that. So I did wind up with about 5.5 gallons in the fermenter, which I was happy with. And overall, you know, other than the beginning issues with the app, the brew day was pretty uneventful. Didn't have any real issues with it at all. But, you know, it's one of those things, again, you know, I've had a lot of comments on the first video about the price. I think that, you know, this unit is maybe pricing itself out of the market, quite honestly, because a lot of people have really balked about the price. I don't know, you know, if they're going to do anything about that, but I think really for them to be able to even think about selling this unit in the United States, it's going to have to drop in price. I mean, you know, that's kind of where I'm at with it. It does brew beer. It does boil. No problems with that at all. Had a good rigorous boil with it. But, you know, just for the price, people have not been interested. So, you know, that's my brew day. That's my opinion. I generally don't give my opinion too much on videos, but I just wanted to, you know, kind of feedback what I was seeing in the comments and everything that I've received through social media everywhere. And that's pretty much a general consensus that the consumers have out there. So This has been Brian for Short Circuit of Brewers. We'll see you on the next video.